It's with great pleasure that I present the Golden Gavel Award to our 2000-2001 Golden Gavel recipient, Jim Cathcart.
Thank you, Madam International President. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. Oh, don't you wish every audience would do that for you? What a great way to start. And I'm also, this is like a family reunion for me. I've got friends throughout the audience, and I have some special guests here that I'd like to take a moment to acknowledge. First off, present in the audience today, the president, current president of the National Speakers Association, who is also married to a former president of the National Speakers Association, Jim and Naomi Rohde. Yeah. And we've got quite a lineup. There's so many people to acknowledge, I'd end up spending an awful lot of time here doing acknowledgments instead of sharing my message with you today. So let me acknowledge my friends and family in the front row. Thank you for being here. Yes, there we go. As a member of the National Speakers Association, I received their publication, which is Professional Speaker Magazine. In the July-August issue, there was an article by Becky Nickel out of Florida. Becky Nickel wrote, you'll love the title of this, Blessed Are We Who Speak. Isn't that a great title? Listen, just a couple of clips from this. Blessed are we who speak, for we are the bearers of good tidings. We instill hope in those who have lost their faith in life. We inspire our fellow man to discover the goodness within him and share that goodness with the world. We encourage leaders to have integrity and ethics, to lead with compassion and understanding, and to realize that they are role models for future generations. I like this part. Blessed are we who speak because we hang out with the neatest group of people in the world. Our heroes are men and women of honor and wisdom who have left the world a better place than they found it. Yeah, absolutely, and good for Becky Nickel, huh? My title today, All Leadership Starts with Self-Leadership. In 1972, I lived in Little Rock, Arkansas, where I was born. I was working as a clerk for $525 a month for the Little Rock Housing Authority, the Urban Renewal Agency. I was an assistant to a man who was not busy. And I was sitting there one day on the job, I was kind of doodling and just kind of, you know, just filling time. And in the next room, the radio was playing, and I heard this voice on the radio.
In order to become a professional in a world of amateurs, we need to study three important subjects. One, our company and the industry in which it operates. Two, our job and perhaps the next step upward in our career. And three, we need to study people, since successfully serving and getting along with people will determine our success or failure. And it can be accomplished in an hour a day devoted to reading and making permanent notes. Study one book or one article at a time, an hour each day, will lead to your becoming an expert at your particular job and industry in 5 years or less.
Whose voice? Absolutely, Earl Nightingale, the Dean of Personal Motivation, Earl Nightingale. And what he said was, one extra hour of study each day, and you'll be a national expert in your field in 5 years or less. Now, when I heard that, remember, I was a government clerk. So I'm sitting there thinking, an hour a day. I got 8 hours a day. I could do this by Thursday. Then I had a new dilemma. What am I going to be an expert at? Well, it wasn't going to be urban renewal. And the more I thought about it, the less that appealed to me. And then finally it hit me. I want to do what the guy on the radio is doing. But I had two conditions, that is, that would inhibit one's speaking career. One, I had never given a speech. Two, I had nothing to say. That'll hold your fees down, right? Well, so I thought about what Nightingale has said. Okay, an hour a day extra studying this field, in 5 years or less, I'm a national expert. Heck, if he's telling the truth, I got it nailed. So I started overcompensating, 2 hours, 3 hours. You remember Jim, right? My son, Jim Jr. He remembers, Paula remembers enduring this. I was a fanatic about personal growth, reading books, listening to tapes, getting records, you know, going to seminars, anything I could do. Sure enough, within 5 years, I was working full-time as a trainer, leading courses that other people had designed. Within a year or two after that, I was authoring my own courses. And ever since then, I've been flying around the world and giving speeches, and I've had the privilege of being president of the National Speakers Association, and the greatest privilege a speaker can receive, the Golden Gavel Award. Wow. Thank you. Thank you. All of this began with one inspiring message on the radio. One little inspiring message in one random broadcast that day, at least to me it was random. And I just happened to hear those words at the time I needed them, and it gave me the tools with which I could change my life. Boy, we have a privilege on this platform, as my friend Naomi Rhody would say. What a privilege and what a responsibility, because people take us seriously. When you stand before a group and you deliver with conviction a message, people take it as truth. So we have a huge responsibility to make that a message that uplifts rather than tears down. A message that inspires rather than discourages or plants seeds of doubt. Boy, what a privilege we have. Well, back in 1979, I was in Chicago to give a speech for an outfit called Tidy Car. How many of you know what Tidy Car is? Few of you do. Tidy Car is an auto detailing company. And Tidy Car, back in those days, was a company which sold franchises for $1,500, little kit. So you'd get this polishing material and this tool with which to do what they called preserve a shine. And you could go out and start your own auto detailing business. And they were selling these things like hotcakes. I mean, that was the heyday of franchising. So back in those days, lots of people were buying Tidy Car franchises, and Tidy Car realized they had to start training these people. So they brought in speakers like me to come and address them once every month or so around the country. Well, I was the flavor of the month for Chicago, so I showed up and I gave my speech. There was about maybe 200-300 people in the audience. At the end of my speech, a young guy, 19 years old, came up to me, innocent-looking face, looked like he'd never even had a dirty thought. I mean, just, you know, white hair, white eyebrows, and just this little smile on his face. His name was Tim Seward. And Tim Seward came up to me and he said, "Mr. Cathcart, could I sit with you at lunch?" And I said, "Certainly." So he sat with me, asked me 1,000 questions. At the end of lunch, he said, "One more question." I said, "Sure. Do you have a quote or a slogan, a motto that you could give me as a daily motivator?" And I said, "Well, let me think about that." I said, "I've got something better, Tim. I've got a question. And here's the question. Every day, ask yourself this question as often as you can remember to ask it. How would the person I would like to be do the things I'm about to do? Don't think of someone else. Think of you in the future as you grow and mature and advance. How would the more refined version of you do the work you're setting out to do right this moment or during this day?" In other words, if you keep thinking like an acorn, you'll remain an acorn. So you got to think like an oak to start the growth process. He said, okay, our day, or not our day, excuse me, a question every day, how would the person, I said, well, what, tell me something about the person you'd like to be. He said, well, I'd like to be the international sales leader for Tidycar. I said, good, use that question. What happened was he went back home to Bay City, Michigan. He got rid of his t-shirt and jeans and he put on a little jumpsuit, had Tim embroidered on the pocket, Tidycar on the back. So now he looks more professional, because he figured the international sales leader wouldn't wear a t-shirt and jeans, right? Then he started organizing his files better. Then he got a picture of a Corvette, which they were going to give to the international award winner that year. And he put that over his bed, and he put another picture of a Corvette over his workbench so he'd see it every day. And that inspired him to think like the international sales leader. He ended up growing his business so well that he had to hire other people to work with him, and ultimately had to lease a service station so he had a permanent location. His business absolutely thrived. You see, we can take one simple question and just shift our perspective enough to give us profound insights that will transform the results we get. But it takes the stimulus to start the process. And if we're seeking the stimulus and we're taking responsibility to make that happen, the process will indeed work. And I've seen it, as you have, again and again and again. If you want to be more intelligent about something, notice more. They say intellect is the ability to make distinctions. So the person who makes the most distinctions or notices the most details in any situation sees the most options. And the person with the most options usually wins. Okay? To know more, notice more. Specifically, notice what's coming. What's coming in your field? And more importantly, what do you need to do to get ready for it? Last July, I got a call from my son, Jim Cathcart Jr. He's working at the Four Seasons Resort up in Santa Barbara. And he called me and he said, well, it happened. I said, gosh, what? He said, I'm becoming you. I said, you poor child. What? Tell me about the details. He said, well, he said, Dad, I've moved from the sales department to human resources and they just made me training manager. I'm becoming you. I said, then join Toastmasters. And he did. Jim, say hi to the group. See, if you don't get ready for your opportunity, the opportunity won't be there for you. It may be an opportunity to someone else, but it's not yours if you're not ready for it. So you got to be skilled in the way that you have to be skilled at the time when you need to apply those. And you've got to get ready before you get there. 21st century. I think we ought to take a look in this new century at the trends in a number of areas. Not just trends in our own chosen craft or field, but trends in society in general, in business and so forth. Looking at technology, human relations, how people communicate. What are the trends? What's changing? Because things are seriously changing. Take a look at this. Saturation rates. Now, saturation is the point at which something reaches 30% adoption in the marketplace. So 30% of the people have embraced whatever it is. From that point, they call that kind of a flash point. That's critical mass, where it starts just growing exponentially after that. How long did it take various technologies to reach 30% saturation? For the telephone, it took 38 years. People would say, I'm not going to talk to a machine on the wall. If I want to talk to Mary Lou, I'll do what I always did. I'll just walk myself over and say hi. You know? So the telephone kind of did well after that, didn't it? Okay? Television took 17 years. 17 years from the time it was released to the public to the time 30% had one. Of course, there was nothing to watch for about seven of those years. Personal computers took 13 years to catch on. Look at that. Wireless phones, 10 years. Think back 10 years ago. Remember this? We're on their front porch. Hello? Guess where we are? Right? It was a big deal back then, right? Today, we just say, get a life, you know? Oh, man. The internet took 7 years from the time it came out for all of us non-scientific types, okay? What's next? Who knows? There's so many things. We've got to keep our eye on the possibilities beyond our own area of involvement. For example, what technologies can you think of that in the next probably 5 or 6 years will be obsolete? Technologies we're all familiar with, but in the next few years they will be obsolete. Call it out. Fax machines, there you go. VCRs, absolutely. Because we're going to be downloading it off of the internet or through the cable or whatever. We're going to get TiVo. Thank you, Sue and Tony Alessandra. They sent us one as a housewarming gift. We got so many things. Film cameras. It's going digital, right? I mean, you think about the things that we're accustomed to. Keyboards. When you got voice recognition that actually works, what do you need a keyboard for, right? So there are lots of things that we're very comfortable with, very familiar with. Printed phone books, probably going digital before long, right? Lots of things are changing, and we've got to keep our own aperture in this camera open for seeing what's out there and what's coming, and certainly not embrace what's there too strongly. The first thing we've got to do is make sure that the critical technology is handled. The CBLF servers, you know, in any suite of technology, the server is what makes it all work. Okay, would there be any questions at this point? Oh, carbon-based life forms. Yes, the human factor, if that's not handled, it doesn't matter how good the rest of it is, does it? The world around us is changing more than we are, so the question becomes, in what ways are you currently obsolete? We're all obsolete on some level, agreed? Yeah. Or as we say in the South, could I get an amen to that?
Amen.
Hey, hallelujah. Okay. Give you a little insight into how we become obsolete. Just a little perspective here. This is a briefing that's sent to the faculty each fall at Beloit College in Wisconsin. It's sent to give them a hint, a clue, as to what this incoming freshman class is like. The people who started college this past fall were born in 1982. Born. They have no meaningful recollection of the Reagan era. Didn't realize he'd been shot. During the Persian Gulf War, they were prepubescent. Whew. They were 9 when the Soviet Union broke up. They don't remember the Cold War. Atari predates them. What's Atari? Well, it's like Nintendo. Like what? PlayStation. Oh, yeah, okay. You say to them, you sound like a broken record. They say, what? CDs came out the year they were born. Never heard of an 8-track. Have never seen a TV with only 13 channels. No kidding, Grandpa, you used to have to walk across the room to change. Whoa. Dude. They've always had VCRs. Jay Leno's the only person that ever was on The Tonight Show. And in 2 to 4 years, they're going to be your customers, your coworkers, and in some cases, the one you report to. Whoa. So in what ways are we currently obsolete? Many more than we know. I tell you, it makes a difference. We can never stop relearning. See, if your job evolves faster than you do, you're out of date. You're easily replaced. So never stop relearning. And we've got to learn what Toastmasters teaches, first of all. Learn what's typically called, and I find it an insulting term, soft skills, because they're not soft by any means. They are the skills that produce the hard realities, the outcomes that we want. Okay? But learn personal competence, learn social competencies. See, self-leadership, that's the key here. Soft skills don't become obsolete. They're portable. you can take you to a new environment and you can lead there. So here's a leader's dilemma. All right, what if I train my people and then they just leave? Well, that's a valid concern. Here's a more important concern. What if you don't? And they stay. That would be self-inflicted mediocrity, okay? Boy, I tell you. See, the first thing we've got to do as leaders is we've got to get our people to embrace the genetic code of the organization. They've got to know the purpose, the vision, the mission, values, brand identity that we've chosen for the organization. In Toastmasters, it's real clear. From the time you join Toastmasters, you learn of Ralph Smedley's vision. You learn of how the organization has evolved over the years. You see what this organization stands for, who it cares about, and why, and what they do. Friends helping friends succeed. Wonderful theme, wonderful theme. Okay, so the first role of a leader is to get their people to embrace the genetic code. Now look at this, I'm gonna draw a quick little parallel between the industrial era that we just left and the eco-tech, if you will, era that we've now entered. Instead of looking at organizations as machines, we look at them as living organisms. Instead of doing business 9 to 5, we do business all 24 hours a day. Formal education is now perpetual education. You never stop learning. Eye contact has been supplemented with e-contact. If you can only do it face-to-face, you're missing opportunities. You gotta be able to reach people electronically and bond as well. Used to be, it's not what you know, it's who you know. But what I wanna know is who knows you back? Whose Rolodex or database are you in? That tells me who your real contacts are, right? And IQ is being supplemented with EQ, emotional intelligence. We used to say knowledge is power. Now knowledge is available to everybody. Access is power. Sales used to be persuasion. Now it's partnering. Used to be about keeping up. Today, keeping up is impossible, so we just got to stay in the game, right? Do-it-yourself is now do-it-together. No more lone wolf. Institutions rule has given way to individuals rule. Now think of that one. In a time when information and power has shifted from institutions, organizations, to individuals, when the individual has the access to information and therefore has the power to make decisions, self-leadership is king. Self-leadership is king. Because if you can't lead you, please don't lead me. Right? In a time when self-leadership is king, those who can't get themselves to do what needs to be done when it needs to be done, whether they feel like it or not and still do it well, don't lead, they lose. Right? Self-leadership, the ability to get yourself to do what needs to be done, when it needs to be done, whether you feel like it or not, and still do it well. So that's four elements. If you look at it, it's action, what needs to be done, timing, when it needs to be done, motivation, whether you feel like it or not, and quality, still do it well. My friend Greg Godek, author of 1001 Ways to Be Romantic, saw this and he said, you and I have something in common we can use as a reference. I said, what's that? He said, I have a new son, you have a new grandson. He said, self-leadership certainly applies when it's time to change a baby's diaper. You must do what needs to be done. When it needs to be done. Who cares whether you feel like it? And if you get it wrong... By the way, would you like to meet my grandson? This is Jason Tyler Cathcart. Jason, stand up and say hi to the group. 6 months old today. That's his mom, Sonia, sitting there glowing. Yes. No one need live a minute longer as he is because the Creator endowed us with the ability to change ourselves. J.C. Penney said that. So Tidy Car called me again. They said, Jim, we're having a convention in New Orleans. We're giving away a Corvette. Want to speak? You bet. So I go to the Hilton Hotel in the French Quarter down in New Orleans, standing there in front of a large group of the Tidy Car franchisees from around the world. And they say, Jim, as soon as you give your keynote speech, we're going to give the award. I said, who won? They said, not telling. I said, okay. So I get up there and give my speech. I hand the microphone over to the president of the company. He steps up and he says, ladies and gentlemen, what a contest. Listen to these numbers. The person who came in number two led number three by only 1 point. One. Three led four by 1 point. Four led five by 2 points. Five led six by 1 point. Tight competition. Except for number one. The person who leads this contest, number one, the international sales leader, led the contest with 300 more points than number two. For first place, there was no competition. Welcome with me. Your international sales leader from Bay City, Michigan, Tim Seward. The place went insane. Everybody dancing, screaming, cheering, hugging each other. A few people took advantage of that. It was fun. Everybody's having a good time. They bring Tim on their shoulders to the front of the room. They put him on the stage. He's up there caressing the Corvette as much as you can do that to a vehicle. I came over. I gave him a bear hug and I congratulated him. I said, Tim, what did you do? He said, I just did what you said in Chicago. I said, specifically. What did I say in Chicago? He said, come on, Jim, you know. The daily question, how would the person I'd like to be do the things I'm about to do? And he told me the story I shared with you a little while ago. And I said, wow, I am so proud of you. That's great. And he said, oh, it gets better. What? He said, well, you know, I didn't know if I'd won. I knew I was in the running, but I didn't know if I'd won. So I'm getting ready to come to New Orleans to the convention, and I'm thinking, okay, how would the international sales leader go to New Orleans? I figured he'd go first class. One way. I said, no, wait a minute, Tim. You didn't know you'd won. He said, correct. I said, but you bought a first class one-way ticket to New Orleans and you didn't know you were the winner. He said, right. I said, doesn't that seem a little foolhardy? He said, hey, Jim, think I'll need a ride home? The boy had a Corvette. Gad, I mean, good for Tim, huh? What a great example of taking one simple idea to the max. I mean, I like that so much, I put it on a mouse pad. And now I now have that on my desk. And here, you want a mouse pad? There you go. Daily question. Good catch, by the way. One little simple question absolutely transformed his life. Look at this, a quote from Dan Burris, a friend of ours. Dan's a futurist. He says, it's a mistake to assume people know what they might want, because if they don't know what's possible, they ask for too little. Isn't that the truth? So part of our job as leaders is to stretch people's expectations. The more they expect, the more they get ready for. The more they get ready for, the more possibilities they have. And the person with the most possibilities usually wins. It matters. Aim high, because the future you see defines the person you'll be. 1993, National Speakers Association Convention, Dallas, Texas. I was the opening keynote speaker on Sunday. What a day. After me, the next speaker was Art Linkletter, another Golden Gavel winner. Art Linkletter was backstage, and he and I were just sharing stories, and he told me a story that stuck with me ever since. He said, Jim, I used to take vacations with Walt Disney, to which I said, wow, really? And he said, yeah. He said, one year we went to Tivoli Gardens in Copenhagen, beautiful place. We're wandering around, and I noticed Walt was taking notes. And I said to him, what are you doing, Walt? And Walt says, Art, notice the little twinkle lights up in the trees. And Linkletter said, yeah, they're pretty. He said, no, none are burned out. Do you see the benches? Freshly painted. And the bathrooms are clean. And Linkletter said, so why are you writing this down? And Disney said, well, someday I'm going to build a place like this for families. Ooh. Disneyland was taking shape in the mind and heart of Walt Disney at that time. And right outside our doors here is the evidence of what that can do. Wow. Walt Disney, when he set the goal to create Disneyland, was not yet the person who could pull it off. See, if you don't get ready for your opportunity, it's not your opportunity. So the first thing he had to do was go to work on Walt Disney. He was a guy who'd been bankrupt a couple of times. He was primarily a cartoonist and a movie maker. He wasn't an empire builder. Certainly hadn't been in the theme park business. He had to become the kind of person really substantial people would want to invest money with at significant risk. He had to become the kind of person that the most talented artists in the world would want to cast their lot with him just to be in on the dream he was painting. He was aiming high, but that high aim told him what qualities he had to cultivate in himself to be an eligible recipient for that high aim. So what do you see for your future? Let me suggest that you're probably enormously underestimating what's possible for you. Interesting combination of words, enormous underestimation, okay? But think about it. You're probably underestimating you because almost nobody from inside themselves has a real clear perspective on what's possible. Aim higher and then ask yourself, if that's what's coming or could be, what do I need to do to get ready for it? One of the things you can do is build your equity, your professional equity, not your home equity, but build your reputation intentionally. Decide today what reputation you want 10 years from now with your colleagues. What do you want your friends and family members saying about you behind your back? What do you want your neighbors to think about you and feel about you? What do you want the people in your industry to think when they think about you? Design your reputation today and then grow to fit it, one element at a time. The reason I put wealth up there is, like Patricia Fripp said last night, you tend to listen more to multimillionaires. Right? So you might as well become one. Now let me wrap all this together. Lead with your heart, guide and manage with your head. Here's one way to look at that. A friend of mine said, well, it's all about share of wallet. I said, excuse me? He said, yeah, look at your wallet. I looked at it. He said, it's your credentials, your identity. That's part of the picture. He said, it's your cash. That's another part. And it's your clout, what you're able to do. It's share of wallet. I said, well, I think you're looking in a good place, but I would expand my search. I said, because to me, it's the connections that make all the rest of this matter. And if you don't handle this part of it, then the chances are good the other part of it won't mean much. Lead with your heart. That's where inspiration comes from. The heart makes a poor manager, but a great inspiring leader. The head makes a poor leader, but a very efficient manager. Keep them in their appropriate roles. It makes a lot of sense. So 1998, here I am. I'm in Fort Myers, Florida, at the airport. I'm being met by a 39-year-old man, Tim Seward. 39-year-old man. He's driving me, not in a Corvette, but in his SUV. He's driving me to his home in Naples, Florida, where we're having dinner by his indoor pool. And he tells me about his life. Well, I sold my tidy car business, made a pretty good, you know, bit of money on that. I sold that business after, the one that I formed after Tidy Car, and then I built another business, and I just sold that business this last December, he said, for $7 million. He said, I'm 39 now, so I retired to Florida. He said, where what I do now is I fly my wife and son around the world to see the places we want to see, and when I'm at home, I take classes to get my MBA. I said, Tim, I've just got one question. He said, what's that? I said, do you have a quote? Or a slogan, you know, or a motto, something I could use for a daily motivator. True story, here's what he said. Yes, Jim, ask yourself every day, how would the person I'd like to be do the things I'm about to do? Thank you so very much. Thank you. Thank you.
For more information on booking Jim Cathcart to speak to your convention or to inquire about his books, videos, and recordings, contact Cathcart Institute Incorporated at 1-800-222-4883 or go to www.cathcart.com on the web.